Welcome back, everybody. Time now for our second game of the best of three, Tongfu versus CDEC Youth. It's looking like CDEC Youth with a bit of an edge over Tongfu for now. They took game one, but game two, a new draft, a new beginning for Tongfu, and we'll see what they can do here to look to bounce back, force out of game three. I'm God, joining me as Winter, and, well, things getting underway here, Winter. How are you feeling?
Dude, I joined the wrong lobby.
GG, are you not in my lobby? Radiant
team pick. No.
Oh, you fail fish.
I just realized when the game started, there was like two lobbies. I didn't realize I joined the wrong lobby.
All right, well, we can head on over to the watch tab and we can coordinate up there. Let me head on over there. Do you see the game in the watch tab?
I think so.
Let me see if I can spectate. Let's go there. Let's go in game, and then we can be synced up at least.
Sorry, my bad. I didn't realize I was eating. I thought I joined the right lobby. Then I realized there was two lobbies with the same name. I think they remade the game.
Yeah,
right?
There were two. I saw two when I joined. One of them had 9 of 10 players. So I was like, I think this is the right one.
That's my bad. Sorry.
All right, we're good. Jack can use directed camera now. I won't miss any kills. I love it. I wonder. Let's give directed camera a shot, hey? Let's put Valve under the gun to do some good camera work here. But are you in the watch tab now? Did you make it in?
Yes.
Phew. We did it. So game two, Tongfu versus CDEC. I should know what they're gonna ban because I just saw what they're gonna ban, but I've already forgotten now. Unfortunately, I'm guessing they ban out. Well. Tongfu will ban Gyrocopter, and CDEC Youth will ban... what are they going to ban, Winter?
Lina. You tell me. That's you already cool. Saw it.
I know. I've already forgotten. My short-term memory is no good.
Yeah, but from the last game, I think if they wanted to play like how they did the last game, Tongfu, I think they have to just pick lineups that fight much better as a team instead of like, because Klings and Tia are all very single. I mean, Tia is fine, you can have one of those, but you don't have two. If you have Tia and Klings, you have two heroes that are very, you know, single target focus. And it's not
no Jaru ban.
Shaker ban I was talking about, right? I can see that you ban their Shaker because that guy, he plays the Shaker, like, he fits their team, man. He plays the Shaker very well in the early stages. He roams very effectively most of the time. He does stacks, and that's how CDEC wants to play the game. They just keep stacking and they farm their mech or whatever core items they have, and they group up and keep fighting.
I feel like in game one, Tongfu, they first picked Tusk and they wanted to draft a 5-man lineup because that's what they did yesterday. They had like a Dazzle mid with an Undying, but both Dazzle and Undying were taken, and those were two heroes I feel like Tongfu wanted. I don't think they were expecting both Dazzle and Undying to get taken from them.
Yeah, true. But then again, they picked themselves into it as well, right? If they still wanted to group and 5-man, they would have picked another carry. Like, Klings and TA together, it's... you just get the Aegis and you try to stall and buy time or get pickoffs and whatnot. It's different from the way they were playing the last game. They were playing as though they had a very good 5-man lineup to fight.
Well, a slightly different style of opener from Tongfu. They get Queen of Pain with Bounty Hunter. So going for lane dominance, perhaps, with their picks, and they're going to then look to deny some of that 5-man away from CDEC Youth. They ban out Undying. They couldn't prevent the Dazzle from coming up, but you kind of know what to expect when you see that Gyrocopter. He's going to go safe lane, and when he hits level 7, level 8, you've got to expect him to look to start rotating, TPing to lanes, even earlier than that if you're diving towers. This Gyro fella is always looking to make plays happen in other lanes with that TP in.
Yeah, the Queen and Bounty is a very similar opening to the Lina and Bounty. You just want to kill, get a lot of kills, and you want to dominate the laning phase. And you want to split up the map most of the time. You can still build a lineup that focuses around fighting together. It really depends on what I want to do, because Bounty can still track your vision and you can still take a fight if you have the appropriate lineup to do so, unlike the last game. If they wanted to fight as a team, I think they shouldn't pick like too much single target focus heroes. They had too many of those in the last game. This game, if they want to fight, they need more, you know, AoE disable. Since they have Bounty now, the rest of the heroes need to have a lot of, you know, AoE spells so that you can actually take team fight against Gyro and Dazzle. Well,
bans onto PL and Winter Wyvern, so we'll see Tongfu's last ban. Probably a slightly 5-man oriented hero you'd expect, as that seems to be where they're headed with the draft for CDEC Youth, but As to what that's going to be, we'll have to wait and see.
Darkseer, maybe. Darkseer is very 5-man.
Yeah.
If they don't want to pick the Darkseer, Darkseer plus Gyro is just very hard to deal with as well.
Another hero we've seen banned a bit, not as 5-man oriented, is Spirit Breaker, but maybe something that Sirik could consider.
Yeah, that was like the hero that was banned first phase every game yesterday.
Yeah. Completely out of nowhere somewhat. And they will ban Spirit Breaker, so...
Because they have the bounty, so they don't want to deal with the... Bounty is a hero that gets countered a lot by Spirit Breaker just because of how the heroes interact with each other in the team fight or in the game itself. You want to go look for kills, you want to go look for tracks, and Spirit Breaker can just act as a homing missile. You know, the target is locked on you and you're not going to escape. And it's a very tanky hero for Bounty Hunter to harass and kill in the early game.
And they just shore up their offlane for now. Get Clockwork, a good counter initiator. Can hit a timing where he does well against Gyrocopter. If you complete the blade mail before Gyro has a BKB, hooking a Gyrocopter can often lead to a kill for your team. So a handy hero to sometimes have against Gyro, but by no means a all-encompassing counter to Gyro.
I've been looking at like a lot of dazzles that get countered by Clock as well during the past. Clock would just hook the Dazzle to prevent the Dazzle from actually graving the cause, you know. So it's also a good way of dealing with the Dazzle. You just force the Dazzle to self-grave and the cause won't have the protection from the Dazzle after that.
Well, see, like, you just snag standard, a support that can at least handle the Clockwork.
Very standard reply for the Clockwork. Just get the Rubik plus Gyro against the Clockwork. So the Clockwork has a tough laning phase, and even they have a Dazzle. If they want to lane the Dazzle at top. But as of now, I think the Dazzle can be set up at a position where you do dual lanes on the offlane to pressure as well if they want to. Because the Gyro plus Rubik lane is already enough to actually make sure that the Clockwork doesn't do too much in the lane.
Yes, absolutely. Well, we'll see if there's some kind of offlaner that CDEC can run with the Dazzle and be pesky with. Tongfu picked up a Storm, so they've got strong lanes here. That's where you're looking at either Queen of Pain or Storm in the safe lane, both with a ranged advantage and decent nuke potential, so not easy heroes to dual lane against by any means. If you want to run a Dazzle plus one, you'll need something pretty tanky, or you need something ranged that can just stay away from those Storm Remnants, potentially. But we'll see what CDEC Youth get out of this.
Yeah, they need Disable as well. They don't have very solid Disable for Queen and Storm, both heroes that are very mobile. Offlaners with Disable, recently I've seen what something that I like is like Slada offlane.
Legion Commander.
Where's Legion? Legion is not so reliable.
Well, it's not Disable, it's a different kind of pesk. The Broodmother comes out. It was banned out in game one in the second stage. We've seen a lot of 4th pick broods, and against IG, it's an insta-ban hero as your 3rd or 4th ban, just because no one wants to let Lua get this. And CDEC Youth have managed to get June a Broodmother for the offlane.
Brood plus Dazzle, they have the combo if they want to go into that, but Tongfu is not like they're too worried, I feel. They have heroes that can deal with the Brood later very well. Even in the laning phase, Queen and Storm struggles a bit, but you can still hold the lane. Without losing the lane, without getting crushed, you know, like in the lane, you can still hold the lane. And when they get the Bounty Hunter track, they have Storm plus track, you know, it's very easy for them to hunt down the Broodmother. It's not like those games where we always see Broodmother dominate because the opponent doesn't have the right set of heroes to deal with the Broodmother. And Tongfu has the last pick to pick a support that can deal with the Broodmother.
Yep. Well, supports that deal with Brood are kind of limited, I feel, often.
Yeah, very limited. Usually you go for Sand King, usually. But Sand King in this position, I'm not sure if they want to go for it because they might want a support that can help in the lane more. Because Sand King is more focused on getting your own farm in the jungle.
Yep.
And you have Storm. Storm wants to use the jungle as well, so it might actually get too crowded in the jungle.
It may just be something more standard like a Witch Doctor or something, I feel, but we'll see.
Witch Doctor sucks versus Root.
Yeah. I mean, there's nothing that great, like, as far as zoning range supports go. There's, like, Rubick and Dazzle being taken by your opponent. Lina and Wyvern are banned out. There's limited options here. Unless you start going for, like, Crystal Maidens and Disruptors.
I know what you're going to say. Crystal Feeden.
Crystal Feeden, yeah. I don't know. Tongfu was the team back at DAC. They were the ones running the support Queen of Pain. Support Queen of Pain against Brood is not bad. You know, you've got a blink escape. You're not like most supports die to a Brood once Brood is Spiderlings. Queen of Pain, you just blink away.
Not bad for the first few minutes. Then yeah. You don't do anything after.
Oh, you then you start leveling up your AoE nuke. You scream spiderlings and easy farm. It's not ideal. And I don't think it's ideal, what they're doing.
The heroes that they want to pick is always bad against Brood, but it's going to synergize. Like you talk about the Disruptor, whatever. It's going to synergize well with their heroes, but it's not good against Brood. They have to choose either a hero that's good with their heroes, or they choose a hero that's good versus Brood. Either way, they cannot have both, I feel.
Well, a Zeus banned out by CDEC Youth.
Interesting, you know. Zeus is really good with Storm. It's a very good combination. You just zap and Storm finds a target and you kill the target. But Zeus support is... 5 seconds. It's food for Brood, though, later. When she gets her levels.
Yeah.
Easy kill. I mean, I guess you have the spam to clear the spiderlings, but because you're a support, you won't have the mana pool to sustain your spells. So it's kind of a weird ban, in my opinion.
So we'll see what Tong Fu look to snag here. This is their response to the Brood in some ways.
I still think Sanking is one of the best, though. I still think Sanking is one of the best to deal with Brood. I mean, you can go for Axe, but then you would have to do your Queen of Pain support. 5 seconds
remaining. Warlock. Not good against Brood by any means, but a fairly tanky support and something Tong Fu have run in the past. Interesting to see a Warlock come up here. What does Warlock do, Winter? What do you see him offering?
I just see the rock coming down and the storm jumping in, the clock hooking in, then the queen blinks in because you're stunned by the rock, so they drop the sonic wave on top of you.
All about the team fight then?
Yeah, Warlock's always all about the team fight. There's no other reason for you to pick this hero if you don't want to go for team fight. It's going to be the Inflame Invoker. They really like this hero.
They like it, especially against like these Storm Quop type things where having an Orchid can offer a lot to your team. Although last time, by the time you had an Orchid, Storm had like BKB and everything, so...
And honestly, I talk about them needing like lockdown for this mobility heroes like Storm and Queen. And if you look at the last ban of Tong Fu, they ban out the Puck as well. So one of the better heroes to lock down the Queen and the Storm.
Yep.
So Invoker could... technically still get the job done, but less effective against... You can't really lock down a Storm unless you have Orchid. But for the Queen of Pain, yes, you can lock down with the Cold Snap if you actually get the procs off constantly. But for the Storm, I would say that he definitely needs to get the Orchid. And if he doesn't get it at a good timing this game, he might actually struggle because everyone on their team needs a lot of space. The Brood is going to be taking up space. Gyro also needs space, so Invoker has to... You know, he has to do a lot of work to make space for the heroes to actually get their job done and especially control the map against the Storm. The Storm and Bounty will be running around and looking for kills. It's going to be up to the Invoker to actually either set up a kill for his team or counter gang the kill.
Alright, I forgot I was blessed by the directed camera. I can go hands off for this Winter, at least for now, until it starts missing stuff. But we're going to introduce our two teams. On the Radiant side, Tong Fu. Gonna have a support Warlock played by LPC. Let's actually get off directed camera before I go crazy. By LPC, we're gonna have U9, the mid laner on Queen of Pain. We've got Faith playing the Bounty Hunter. Really wards sentries for him as he swoops towards the mid lane. It's gonna be ZinQ on the Storm Spirit, and that leaves in the off lane Bingo playing the Clockwork for Team Tong Fu. Hey, Winter, can you introduce C-Deck for me?
Sure, why not? We have ZinQ playing the Storm, LPC on the support Warlock.
C-Deck, Winter. C-Deck, come on.
Sorry, you said Tong Fu. Shit.
Oh.
You messed me up. C-Deck, Jun playing the Brood. We have IC playing the Rubik. Inflame on the Invoker. Demons on the Dazzle. And M. Do you say M or Amy?
I say AIM. I'm not sure of the pronunciation, though. The battle
begins. It's weird.
It's not a very Chinese-sounding name. Although a lot of them have English names.
So they're actually going to put the Dazzle bot, I guess. Dazzle plus Brood. Let's see where he goes. Is he going back top or he's going back
bottom? May just prioritize stacks, for example. Faith is there waiting for him if he walks up.
I definitely can see it work, you know. Like the Dazzle Brood lane can actually beat this Warlock for Storm lane.
Nope, they see Faith. Sentry Ward's been planted early and... doesn't look like he'll get too much out of this pressure on mid lane. Dazzle there waiting from the high ground. Although Faith is going to start trading hits. He decides better against it with the Shadow Wave being available. So, two sentries on June in the early game here in the off lane. And just one on ZinQ. So, Jun likely to have a good time getting experience here. He's not going to get zoned out because of the detection being too much to handle. Denied. He's definitely got an edge there as far as this offlane goes.
Yeah, he's going to get so much on the offlane. I think he might actually be able to crush the lane if he plays the lane correctly. With the Dazzle coming in when the Brute has a bunch of spiderlings, it's very easy to get a kill with the heal bomb. So we'll see if that actually happens for C-Deck here. I don't think the Brute will be shut down at all this game. She's going to be able to have free reign in the lane and just get her levels free and easy.
Important play by Faith at mid. There was a sentry planted by Inflame, but immediately he takes it away with a Tengo, and they don't deal with the Radiant sentry at the same time, so Bounty still has some reign over this mid lane.
They're coming down with the dust on the Bounty.
Yes.
They have Upheaval on the Warlock, so I'm not sure if they can actually get this kill. We'll see.
Level 2 Storm, so they've got the Overload as well. Sentry goes down to lead things off. They dust and everything. They want to get this kill. Upheaval comes out. June's got to outrun it. He drops down another web. Dust still there. One more Overload charge hit. Just barely they get the kill. That's a handy way of getting a kill. They had to commit a lot, but worth it in the end.
If the Brute had a Stout Shield, I'm not sure if they get a kill, but Brute didn't have a Stout Shield there.
Yeah. I mean, he can't really because of the sentry wards. Like, he wants to buy his own sentries. Like,
and he bought the Soul Ring recipe as well. Yeah. This is like the greedy build.
Sort of. If you're going greedy, you don't get the sentries, I guess.
You get the supports to buy you the sentries, my friend.
Yes. Then he could have had the Stout Shield. Now he's missing a web here as well. That defensive web he placed to try run away means he's got a little bit of a gap here. His coverage is not really working for him.
Wow, they're taunting. The heck? Are they good friends or something?
I'm not sure what he's...
He's saying, come on me.
Lie? Okay.
Yeah, Lie is just come. He knows the bounty is there.
Yeah. ZinQ gives a little chuckle about that. And we will see a D ward from Demons. As the Sentry Ward. Actually, seeing the Observer Ward, that was a value Sentry that they'd placed some time ago. So, I'm happy about the outcome of that one. And I think June realizes he has to play maybe closer to his tower now with the Upheaval Dust potential to bring him down.
Yeah, and he doesn't have the Stout Shield as well, so he has to be very, very careful. But I still think he's going to be able to get his levels fairly easy. And so we see this happening right now. He has an army of spiderlings, and we see Dazzle moving down towards the lane to help him get a kill.
Yeah. We'll see if...
Easy kill. Warlock is fairly, fairly tanky for support.
They do also have a sentry in lane, so they'll see the big spiderling army coming their way.
It's not going to be easy, though. But it's possible they can actually... how much damage does he do?
Loses his first sentry to a ZinQ Tengo.
He can drop like a 300 damage heal bomb plus one nuke of the spiderling, so it's gonna do around 500 damage, and Warlock has 560, 600 HP, so he should be fine.
Nope. Mid lane, they found a kill. Invoker goes down. Inflame made the taunt. He said, come at me, and they sure did. Faith retaliates. I like it. Faith goes in. What does Qiang mean? Lag. DDoS attack. In the great words of Chi Long Kwa, he was getting DDoSed or something there.
It means it was you are so strong.
I'm sure it was a DDoS, you know?
Denied. That was kind of an unexpected kill, though.
Yeah.
Because he had, like, usually in Invoker you have Tornado and stuff. But I saw he last invoked a Ghost Sword. Maybe he tried to Ghost Sword and escape, and the Bounty still had one dust. I remember the Bounty still had one dust. Yeah, he used the last dust. That's why he died.
Well, for now, Bounty's roaming has been able to find a kill in bottom lane as well as mid, so successful rotations from Faith so far.
They're going to try to set up the heal bomb. They're really desperate on setting it up. The desert has been waiting for so long.
Yeah. I think Tongfu are well aware of it. Like, you look how they're positioning and playing. They're hugging their tower. They know Brood's got a big spiderling army. It's a level 5 Brood as well, so even the nuke will do a good amount of damage if you're not careful. And yeah, just kind of giving up this lane in some ways. And Bounty's going to come back mid. At this point, Inflame can hardly even get XP out of this lane. If he goes too far forward, he's going to get blinked on by U9, who has Sonic Wave available. This is a dead Invoker if he's not careful. But Faith has already gotten bored. He's headed top lane. He's looking for something else, and possibly that something else being a gyrocopter. It's very hard to get this kill as Jaru is about to hit level 6, and that means that there is cooldown and rocket barrage. I don't see this working unless they TP in Queen of Pain, which...
Queen has TP,
yeah,
right?
They've got Queen of Pain TP. Here it comes. They're going for it. And this is a big, important kill to get. They blink, scream, sonic wave, and everything. Probably didn't need the sonic wave, but better safe than sorry.
That was actually really wasteful, though. It's a long cooldown, yeah. But no one was close to dying, though, so they could have actually right-clicked. He sonic wave when he was like 100 HP.
They'd already used, like, once he's got the cooldown off, like, you're already all kind of low, but they weren't, like you say, they weren't actually close to dying. Yeah. LPC.
It's like, it's a very massive thing, though. Sometimes people don't really understand how important is all these cooldown things, especially with a spell that has a 130 second cooldown at level 1. It's a huge cooldown. And right now, they can actually play very aggressive at bottom because the queen doesn't have the sonic wave. So they're gonna TP in the Gyro right away after the Gyro died to the sonic wave. So immediately taking advantage of the
He walks into a sentry. Faith gets nuked down. There's the heal bomb. Not entirely needed, but they're gonna look to take this tier 1 bottom tower in.
The whole team is down here.
Yeah, Storm is like, I can't do anything. I'm just gonna go jungle / adventure on elsewhere. Find some of his jungle block though, so.
I don't know about this though, I think they're committing too much heroes. They can actually take this tower with only 3 heroes. They don't need 4 heroes here, then they wouldn't have been wasting a lane.
Rubick hears you, Winter. He's TP top. He's up there looking to get his levels.
You should always do this with only 3 heroes. Then you don't waste the 2 lanes, you know. Getting a tower is necessary, but you don't want to be giving up too much, you know. You don't want to waste other experience and gold on all the other lanes, so... This is always better to do it with 3 and have 1 on 2 lanes.
Well, it's the course of action C-Deck you take, and not much Tongfu can do. Dazzle was the lucky winner of the last hit on the tower, so he gets a decent chunk of gold to his name.
He got a kill and he got a tower, that's it.
Yep. He's a happy fella right now. Faith is nearby, walking around this jungle, probably wary of the fact there may be detection for him.
He's gonna get a courier.
Radiant, Observer, and Sentry, Faith. Oh, he pops out. They saw him. No, it's too late. Career surges away. He's not going to get it. Nice use of the speed burst. And cooldown coming bottom lane. Elsewhere, there's some action happening. It's going to be LPC getting away from that. It was Storm getting the kill on top on Rubick. And Clockwork dying in exchange. So it was a 1-for-1. Rubick actually making the best out of that.
Wow, that was actually really good for the Rubick. The Rubick,
yeah.
he
got XP as well.
He hooked in to kill him, but he got XP before he died.
Well, you talked about Sonic Wave cooldowns. U9 just used it on some Spiderlings. Dire's top tower is under attack. I don't imagine that was good use of the cooldown.
Okay. Dire's structures are they just want to defend a tower so badly, yeah? Middle tower
he just, is under attack. Yeah. That's one way to do it.
Maybe he just played Queen of Pain too much with Aghanim's fallback.
Yeah, it's like, what do you mean it's a 2-minute cooldown, guys? I swear it's not. And it doesn't even look like they're defending this. And now they know there's no Sonic Wave.
That's the thing. Like, I feel like they are not going to defend the tower anyway. They're just going to wait for the next wave of creep and they're going to take the tower regardless.
Tower money is helping the Invoker get some needed cash towards his Orchid because...
Oh, okay. They're backing off, so he actually worked out in the end.
Okay. For now. They're backing off only because they've got an opening here on mid lane. They see LPC, but they don't get the jump. It is still Tongfu with the top farmers in Queen as well as Storm. As C-Deck have been kind of grouping up a bit more and looking to take objectives, but they've spread the farm across their lineup much more evenly.
The next thing they need to do is get the Warlock and Bounty. Both of these heroes need their level 6 very badly. They have to rely on the Clock to make space, so Clock is essentially the much more supporting cast right now for their team, even though Bounty and Warlock is the support.
Yeah. Well, it's going to be the tier 1 mid instead of the tier 2 bottom they go for. They're going to fight around the Invoker and the Gyro. These two, a lot of damage output potential together. And without a Sonic Wave, it doesn't look like they can defend this. So Tornado will catch out Faith, but no detection.
That was a really good
him.
Tornado, though. He was kind of anticipating the Bounty to try and deny the tower. Even though they didn't have any true sight, but it was a good play.
Thank you. Jumps in bottom. Wants the kill in the Brood, but Brood's got backup. Storm's got to be careful. He balls into the cooldown here. The Grave comes out as well. It's a dead Storm, and Brood will survive. Great play coming out from the C-Deck team. They were already rotating down bottom because they had their eyes set on this tier 2 bottom tower, which is already nice and low. And guess what? Sonic Wave's still not quite up. It's up in 5 seconds. U9 could look to... Oh, he's got no TP. tower after tower falling, and Tong Fu unable to make a stand yet.
Needs to farm his Aghanims, you know, gods.
Yes. It feels like he almost needs to rush an axe with how he's using this Sonic Wave this game.
I mean, he definitely is gonna rush the axe this game. They have a lot of, you know, lockdown from the clock and the storm, so I don't think he needs the Orchid. You don't need Orchid to kill any heroes apart from using it to silence the Dazzle, so I think you don't really need the Orchid that much this game. So Aghanims is much more important for them to have. They need the Aghanims to keep fighting all the time. Because their main source of damage right now is the Sonic Wave. Warlock plus Bounty doesn't provide too much damage when you get a hookshot in. Every time the Clockwork hookshot in, he needs the Queen to be there.
Well, Brood kind of just jungling it up for now.
Queen! A Queen!
Queen alive for now, turns, Sonic Wave, gets a kill on one. The Rock also helping things out. Great turnaround coming out from Tong Fu. They get two of the three in the mid lane, and elsewhere it's June getting a kill on Bounty Hunter at bottom. Okay.
Huh? What?
That's better use of the Sonic Wave and the Chaotic Infernal.
The Brute Soul killed the Bounty. Do you have Dust?
Doesn't look like it. It was the maybe. Bounty who had Dust.
Maybe he did though. That's not something you expect to see. He's gonna go into the Orchid on the Brute though this game. Orchid is actually very, very good choice here.
They're gonna have double Orchid with Invoker also going for one.
Yeah, they need to use the Orchid to actually replace the lack of lockdowns on their team, because they don't have too much reliable lockdown apart from the Lift and Cold Snap. Cold Snap is not even reliable against the Storm I mentioned, so they need to have items to deal with the Storm, and Orchid is a very good solution to that.
Well, he's gonna go on into the Roshan pit, and it looks like early Roshan on the cards for C-Deck here. No Medallion, they've got the money for it, they just need the Courier for demons, but it looks like even without it they're just gonna go on in. June has the insatiable hunger. He wants to heal himself up off of Roshan, and here we go. Medallion on its way, so demons will be ready and active with that. Doing what Tong Fu did a poor job of last game, which is taking the early Roshan when you've got the map control as well as the advantage in the early game.
They should be putting this Aegis on the Gyro right now, I think. The Invoker and the Brute. Gyro is very strong right now, so with two lives he's gonna be able to dish out a lot of damage in fights, and it's gonna pretty much make sure that Warlock, without the Golem, Tong Fu can't really take any team fights at all, even though their lineup is very strong with the Golem plus the upheaval.
Well, it's a classic trade. Tong Fu get the top tier 1 tower, C-Deck Youth get Roshan, and C-Deck Youth put themselves in position to take some more towers. It may be the top lane they look to pressure next, because there's a T1 and T2 up there, and also a fight to take. There's a lane being pushed out by Tong Fu, so they may try and get a jump up here, but kind of hard. The Orchid's on the Brood, who's at the bottom lane. They're going to hit a hookshot on Icy. This is a deep jump to be making. There's a counter-initiation potential. The Tornado completely whiffs here. Icy's still alive for now, but will eventually be brought down. Zinkyu's completely depleted on mana. Queen of Pain goes up into the north. In Flame slowed down by the upheaval, and he's out of spells. No Invoke available. He's used his Tornado EMP and Invoke to Cold Snap. The backup just wasn't there. Tong Fu had the numbers. And they're not done. Demons.
Gyro didn't have a TP score.
Oh. And this is track kills as well. At least now it's becoming track kills. Brood did some damage to the bottom tier 3 tower. They're going to drop the Chaotic Infernal.
What is going on?
Clock got some money, I guess. I like how it dropped and didn't even kill the Spiderlings. It did no damage at all. Oh, interesting.
What? They first dropped a Queen of Pain ultimate to clear spiderlings. Now they're dropping rocks to clear.
You know who's worried about his tier 3 towers, okay, which are, those are important. Those protect
Man,
your high ground.
He's not even killing the tower anymore, he's backing off.
Yeah. Look.
I don't know, man. If that thing is worth it.
You know, there's like PGG black holes, there's LPC Chaotic Infernals, I guess, or Chaotic Offerings. Just the way of the Dota 2 world.
I never understand Dota anymore.
Look at him, his rock, it's farming, it's pushing out the bottom lane, it's killing spiderlings. Oh, easy money.
Sure, easy money.
He got like 300 gold maybe? June, oh, he's hiding on the tree patch here. The dust misses and he's escaped now deeper into the Radiant Jungle. Should be okay. They're even pinging roughly where he is. Zinkyu balls in, doesn't throw his own dust, and it wouldn't have hit anyways. And now the push is coming. Gyro this time with a TP and leading the charge with an Aegis.
There's nothing they can do. They don't have Golem, so they can only just push the other lanes.
Yep. I know.
So much for that worth, you know, dropping the Golem.
He may have PGG'd it a little bit. Well, aim. Yeah, he's going to be...
I don't think he was PGG, you know. PGG totally missed the rock. It's like he just wanted to farm.
Or he thought he would just do more damage and like instantly kill the spiderlings, which was not really the case. Mid lane, T1 tower getting low. Gyro gonna drop a cooldown. Does not get the deny though. They could have just kept pushing top and they commit to a TP back, so they don't even get a tower deny here. So I think Tongfu will be pretty happy that they've taken a tower and the push at top has ended for now. There's still a bit of a threat here in the mid lane as CDEC may just change tack and go for this lane instead. Dire lose their courier, oh no! Zinkyu, I think the sniper of that one. And you'll be happy to know, Winter, there's an Ags on U9's Queen of Pain, so he can start spamming out that ultimate. Track stolen though, icy. Gonna be a happy camper.
Maybe if they have Golem soon, they'll try to fight 10 seconds.
Yep.
They can actually burst someone down from rock plus hookshot or rocket with the sonic wave, by the way. They can combo and just give no chance.
Well, they're going
to
go in. It's going to be the gyrocopter. They push him back with the cogs, and a blade mail used will deflect some damage onto the invoker. That's going to, I think, deter the push at this point. June is still waiting in the trees here. Are they going to go one more round? They know the hookshot's on cooldown, so that could give them the incentive to do so, but... gotta be careful, that rock could be coming in soon. U9 has the Sonic Wave. Aim getting fairly low. He's not gonna BKB, so you could very realistically kill this guy twice. If you can kill him once fairly easily without committing big spells, he respawns. That's when you maybe look to drop the rock and Sonic Wave. Already down to half HP on Gyrocopter, and it's gotta be careful here. Cooldown gets thrown.
They're still tracked on the Rubik.
Yeah. And it's been used to maybe go on Faith here. Nice Tornado EMP, Zinkyu, balls away. Does catch the Warlock, and that means no Chaotic Offering, so T2 Tower goes down, and track still being thrown out. Zinkyu goes for a jump, falls backwards though, realizes he doesn't have the backup he needs, and Aegis now expires, so... successful Aegis for the most part. CDEC Youth getting 5 of the 6 outer towers, not all of it, some of it already gone before the Aegis, but most of the outer towers have been claimed by CDEC Youth.
They need to have the BKB on the Gyro as their next priority. I think it's going to be very important for them to, because the last fight they had Aegis, so it doesn't matter. But from now on, I think he needs to get the BKB before they try and siege again. Otherwise, he has a very good chance, because the Rock, the Inferno can actually stun the Gyro and the Dazzle at the same time when they are trying to burst the Gyro. So there's a very good chance that he might not survive even though they have a Dazzle.
Oh, they've caught out the Invoker here. Blink in, Sonic Wave in flame. In trouble, gets graved up to keep him alive a bit longer. Can he ghost walk away? Nope, not when you're trashed. They'll bring him down. Clockwork gets the kill. The rock gets dropped further to the north. Icy will pay the price there, and Faith is still continuing to throw tracks. This is looking great for Tongfu. Striking while the iron's hot as the Aegis has expired. Aim going to turn around and drop a cooldown, but I don't think he wants to run into this. There is four heroes pummeling away, and they can't even go on this low HP bounty hunter as he's getting healed up by the Warlock. Nice bit of play there coming out from Tongfu, immediately going on the offensive once that Aegis expires and once they have their ultimates to use in tandem.
Yeah, thanks to the wards as well. If they didn't have the vision there, it wouldn't have allowed the free pickoff on the Invoker and the Rubik. And the other important thing that they managed to achieve is they killed the Rubik with the track. I think it was also huge for them.
Yeah, take it away from him. So this puts like a lot of money in their hands. They've already got Storm, a Bloodstone, so he wasn't there to start getting some charges out of that, but it's still going to be a hard game to deal with a Storm from the Dire side once he gets maybe an item to get rid of the Orchids. Could see a BKB after the Bloodstone, it's very defensive, but maybe necessary against the double Orchid on the side of CDEC.
Yeah, I think this game is fine because there's two Orchids, then you can actually just get the BKB to actually negate that. I talk about always wanting to get Orchid first, but in this game, I think you might want to prioritize getting BKB first over the Orchid.
June's back to the bottom lane. He's being a constant menace down here. Has finally got his treads. That was what was lost on the courier earlier when it died. So he's got treads working at what looks to be a BKB or possibly an SMY, but more likely the BKB.
I think, yeah, I agree. I think it's more or less BKB because there's a lot of spell damage and blade mail on the clock. You just want to be able to, because they're going to be at some point this going to be forced to take a team fight with the Brute in it. I think the Brute needs to come to a team fight in the current meta. You can't really rat too much with Brute. As much as Brute Mother is a ratting hero, you want to be able to help your team as much as possible. And getting a BKB is important against this lineup of Tong Fu to allow him to actually right click in the team fight. I'll be surprised to see if it's a SMY though.
Yeah. Doesn't seem to be an item which will suit this game at all. And
It's a cool item on Brute, just maybe not this.
Yeah. I've seen it more and more lately. I mean, SMY as an item has just become much more popular over the last few months.
The Brute build I saw that was really good was SMY plus Skadi. I saw Miracle doing that build. SMY, Skadi, then okay. Basher. It's just like how you play Jug and Troll.
Yeah. And just, you can fight any kind of carry head on for the most part. Try and run away from a Brute with SMY, Skadi, and his passive. That's not happening.
Yeah, then you add a blink somewhere along the way.
Well, they're going to push, and this is without having an Aegis on their side. They have got the Gyro BKB. Sonic Wave will clear out the Spiderlings, but that could give...
That didn't do much, though.
No.
The next sweep, they're going to be able to push in. It's 30 seconds downtime. It's not much, but there's still going to be a window that Tong Fu can actually...
creep wave of opportunity here.
Yeah.
At the same time, Roshan is respawning in 30 seconds, though. They don't want to get too risky when they can always just go for Roshan. It looks like the creep wave will be dealt with, though.
Oh, he got tracked again.
Uh-oh. Here we go. The initiation comes in on the clockwork. Nice tornado counter initiation. The back lines, they're looking to bring down the Dazzle, but he gets off a defensive grave on himself. ZinQ's been orchided up, but they haven't got the damage to bring him down during that. And there's no lift to deal with this storm. He balls backwards. They've lost Invoker to start things off. Aim. BKB, there's your Sonic Wave. It comes back up just in time to finish off the Gyrocopter. Blink forward from Queen of Pain. The Scream will get one. They've taken out three. It's about to become four. Make it five. It's a team wipe going the way of Tong Fu. Demons gets brought down. Triple kill for U9. Clockwork with these ballsy initiations just paying off time and time again. The team fight is just a bit too strong for Tong Fu. And that Chaotic Infernal from Warlock, just too powerful.
Probably should have waited to go for the rush, and they, like you mentioned, even though they had a really good initiation on clock, CDAC was also pushing without a 4-star on that team, so it was kind of like a lot of things that allowed them to make that initiation possible for them. And Invoker is the one that's being called out every fight. I think he has to be much more back, you know, behind the fights. He has to allow the Gyro to get hookshot or someone else, then he can actually drop his spells. In the last couple of fights, the Invoker didn't do a whole lot for his team. His spells were just basically used before he was going to die.
And this kind of reminiscent of the last point, which is his farm always suffering. Just Invoker by nature, not a good flash farmer. And we're seeing a very late Orchid come up in flame, only now finishing it at 24 minutes. Brute did get the Orchid off last fight on the Storm, but Storm was so far back that there was no damage. Brute couldn't even attack.
At this point, probably having a 4-star is much better than the Orchid on the evil. So he's having trouble surviving in team fights because the clock is always aiming him.
Yeah. Well, ZinQ invised up. He's looking to get aggressive here, perhaps knowing that CDEC will be eyeing off Roshan. Looking to make sure they can control that area. Tong Fu have 50 seconds before they have the Infernal back up, and that does make things a little bit trickier as far as contesting a potential Rosh. But they've got Rocket Flares being spammed out over the pit, so they'll know as soon as CDEC go in there, as long as they're proactive with that Rocket Spam.
The Storm has actually gone for Orchid. He didn't go for BKB. The BKB was purchased on the Queen, however.
Okay. I guess Queen can be more the one... Queen seems to be the one fighting like the main fight. Storm's just going for the back lines. Like, he jumped the Dazzle, and if he has an Orchid, he just kills the Dazzle. Unfortunately, Dazzle just gets off a self-grave, but... That's still a good result for ZinQ in that last fight. He forces Dazzle to just save himself, and he's not healing up. He's not graving the Gyrocopter in the front lines.
Yeah, I talk about the clock doing that job, but this game, the clock is just initiating in front, and Storm is doing the backline job.
Yeah. And Queen of Pain just fights everyone, assuming there's a Sonic Wave.
Yeah, that's why she got BKB, so she can fight head on.
AIM is not particularly farmed for a Gyrocopter. which is also a concern for C-Deck, I feel. Hasn't gone for any kind of Ancient stacks. It's been June mostly farming the bottom side of the map, including the Ancients. And as a result, Tongfu may have lost game one, but game two is starting to look pretty good for them. They're up by about 7,500 net worth and looking to increase that. Hookshot goes in. They've caught out in Flame again and again. He's being targeted. The Sonic Wave will finish him off. The lift on ZinQ, but he's not done. He's going to ball forward, finds Icy. Somebody finish him off, for God's sakes. There we go. He wants the Curry as well. He'll get it. And now AIM, BKB gonna wear off, and with that, U9 may look to go on in for him. It's June, the only saving grace for this C-Deck side, it feels like, who's kind of keeping him alive. He orchids up the Storm, but that's not a Storm you can kill, and with track on June, he's going down. The Rock comes out now, the ball forward. AIM does not have a BKB, and as a result, ZinQ wanted the kill, didn't quite have the damage, ran out of mana. If he'd known the Rocket Flare was coming, he may have committed for it, but either way, Tongfu 4-0, tier 2 tower, and maybe going for Roshan. They're all kind of low. They don't have the best damage. This is not going to be an easy Roshan. I think they may actually have to back off. We'll see. Actually, no, they're gonna stick around. No medallion, I believe, but this is risky because everyone on C-Deck Youth actually respawns pretty quickly.
Well, the Warlock pick has been really shining in every fight, though. Apart from the one wasted golem on the Spiderlings, every other golem has netted them a team white victory. They won all the team fights with the golem. It's just very hard for them to, you know, fight into it when they don't have four stuff to actually escape from the clockwork. Every time the invoker is down, it's a majority part of their disable, you know, when the invoker is dead. Their team relies on the invoker to drop a lot of his key spells in teamfight, especially the tornado.
Yeah. It's like you say, maybe it should have just gone for the four staff rush because Brood had such a good orchid timing.
I would have actually preferred to have the four staff this game.
Yeah. Often if you've got like a teammate who can get a four staff, but people who get four staff is normally heroes like offlane clockwork. So obviously, if you've got an offlane clockwork, but Brood is not a four staff buy. This is not a utility like kind of offlaner.
Bounty just got a death soul. What the
heck? I saw that. I'm like, oh, okay, why not? More push power, I guess, you know? I don't know. I mean, it goes through the like damage that goes through the gyro BKB in the front line, so.
Is he going to be hitting the gyro?
Probably not with these items. He's kind of squishy.
Bigun actually makes more sense too.
Yeah. I'm surprised by the Deso pickup.
I mean, they actually got the game in the back regardless. They are in a very good position right now, so he feels like he can get away with anything he wants.
The biggest upside to me is you win one fight, you can push and take a lane of Rax faster because of the minus armor. That's probably the biggest upside of this item. Storm up to 16 Bloodstone charges, and that's where it just doesn't feel like C-Deck have the answers for him. He can go for something like a Lincoln Sphere next if he wants to, and then he has even more freedom in a fight. Maybe even goes for a Shiver's Guard if he wants some armor.
This doesn't really target the invoker the whole game.
Yeah, and with an Ag Scepter, he can target him constantly. You're looking at every 12 seconds a hookshot available.
And the gyro is like not farm enough, you know.
He's ridiculously poor for a gyro. This is normally you see gyros, even when they're ganking quite a lot and pushing with the team, staying at least up there on par with the top farmers.
Because they're not winning the team fights. That's why I felt like, even though Brood was like good in this game in the laning phase, but it's not good after because of the composition wise and also because of the Warlock as well. The Warlock was able to just make sure Tongfu wins every team fight. So the gyro and the Brood together is a bit. One wants to keep fighting as a unit, but Brood is not very good at fighting as a unit.
Here comes C-Deck, they get the offensive weave off, but there's a Infernal to worry about. I don't think they want to go charging in the pit. They get the hookshot this time on June. Looking just to start the fight. Sonic Wave from the high ground. June gets graved up, but uh-oh! Demons has been caught by ZinQ. Good news is he did get the grave off. The EMP not going to hit ZinQ. Ball's out. Brood still dead regardless. U9 goes forward with the BKB in flame. He's been spotted and three dead, make it four, as Queen of Pain gets a triple kill, and looking like the end of C-Deck Youth. AIM gets caught out, will BKB defensively, tries to get U9, but short range blink, and it's a team wipe. It's basically three team wipes in a row. There was a 5-0, a 4-0, and then another 5-0. It was 14 unanswered kills coming out of Tongfu, all from their big team fight.
Their team fights were just so reliant on the invoker, though. Because they had a Brood. Brood doesn't do much in teamfights. Invoker needed to somehow not get hooked every time. I felt like because he didn't do, like, the scoreboard shows, right, he had only one assist. So he didn't actually contribute much in this game.
Oh, everybody only has one assist, basically. Yeah, they have four kills.
They only have four kills, yeah. But Invoker should be able to help them in team fights much more. But then again, it's like, I talk about the point where they had Brood and Gyro together, right? These two heroes is kind of like the opposite. One wants to fight as a team a lot. The other doesn't really want to fight too much. You want to split push.
That's where the overall strategy, I think, maybe hurt them more. Because if anything, it's less like, oh, you look at this game and you're like, oh, okay, definitely, it's true the Invoker wasn't able to set up kills or do much. But normally a Gyrocopter doesn't necessarily need a setup. He just TPs to a lane and he's finding kills with ease. But because you've got the Brood and because of the way you're playing this game, it just... the opportunities weren't maybe there, and definitely something, a good point to consider. Picking Gyro and Brood together seems quite poor.
They saw a good opening to pick the Brood though, because of the lack of good supports to deal with the Brood, and it resulted in the Brood getting huge, right? She got big even though she gave up a kill in the lane. But then what you do after that, what's the plan next? You know, maybe if you have an Exort Invoker, then you just keep pushing with the with the summons and the spiders, maybe that might actually work better. I'm not sure though, because this game, it feels like something was really off in their game plan, because they won their lanes with the Brood, but then Invoker lost his lane because he got ganked by the bounty so much. And then the Gyro wanted to fight, right? He built a first item. I mean, he had to build a first item BKB. He can't go for like the greedy Yasha Helm of Dawn build because of the way the game is going. So it's kind of like they are contradicting each other with the way they are built, the way they are running the game plan as itself. But then again, what else could they have done better apart from maybe, even if the Invoker didn't get caught so much, it's still difficult for them to win a team fight.
Alright, well, we're going to a game 3, guys. We're going to quickly hop into the lobby before we miss it this time, so we're going to take a break. When we come back, it's game 3 decider between TongFu and CDEC Youth. I told you to go to a game 3, guys. It'll be right up right after this break. See you then.